mountain village in Switzerland lived a man whose strange experiments with the dead have since become a legend. A legend that is still told with horror the world over.
We've only just started, just opened the door. Look, now's the time to go through that door and find what lies beyond it. But don't you see, Paul? We've discovered the source of life itself, and we've used it to restore a creature that was dead.
This is Frankenstein, who revolted against nature, who experimented with the devil and was forever cursed. His unwilling collaborator was Paul Kremp.
I can't prove you murdered, but I can stop you using his brain.
Why, he has no further use for it.
Don't be a fool! Be careful! You damn it!
Only two women ever entered this house of evil.
Elizabeth, come back!
Elizabeth, the lovely cousin who had promised to marry him, and Justine, the maid, who kept passionate and secret rendezvous with her master.
Won't you understand you're in real danger? What Victor is doing is dangerous to everyone in the house. Now, you cannot possibly conceive what dreadful thing he's planning to do.
What are you trying to tell me, Paul? That Victor's wicked? Insane?
Wicked? Insane? Evil? Call Frankenstein what you will. A demon had made a man-made monster. And now, the monster was the master.
Paul, what are you going to do?
For your sake and to protect Elizabeth, I've so far kept silent. But now I shall go to the authorities and have them destroy that creature. And see that you pay for these atrocities.
No! No!
Hey everybody, this is Michael again, and welcome back to my channel here on YouTube. Well guys, it's that time, finally, I have finally got around to giving my thoughts on the classic Hammer Frankenstein films, and of course this is the first video in that series. This is my thoughts on The Curse of Frankenstein, collected here in a two-film set put out by Warner Brothers. This is The Curse of Frankenstein and Taste the Blood of Dracula. And I had actually never seen The Curse of Frankenstein. And my memory is a little bit cloudy, guys. It seems like, and I think I've said this before, but it seems like on late night film where you'd have shows hosted by vampires, wolfmen, all those crazy comical hosts of the horror films, they never really showed the Hammer Frankenstein films very much. We've seen quite a few of the Dracula films, but I don't remember seeing any of the Frankenstein films other than, you know, still pictures and books when I was a kid in the library at school. They'd have books on Hammer and horror in general, and you'd see stills from the Hammer films, but I never saw the film itself. And it's no secret, guys, I've mentioned this also before, that I never have been really a big fan of the Frankenstein monster. I think as I've grown older, I have come more to appreciate the metaphors of creating life and exactly what the film, from a science fiction standpoint and horror, but mostly science fiction, what the eccentric Baron von Frankenstein was trying to do. And the ideals that the original novel was trying to engrave in the reader and all that. So I've come to appreciate the ideals probably more than the monster itself. And I've always watched the Frankenstein films, not necessarily because I just wanted to watch them, just because they were monster movies. So I've seen, you know, quite a few Frankenstein films, but I've never really seen many of the Hammer, if any at all, the Hammer Frankenstein films. And of course the first film in the franchise is The Curse of Frankenstein. Now of course this stars Peter Cushing, and I gotta say that in itself was enough reason for me to kinda not look forward to seeing the film because I know that Cushing played the villain in the film. And I'm so used to him playing the heroic guy, the good guy character, that I really didn't want to see him as a bad guy. But my love for the gothic horror that is Hammer kind of pulled me in the direction of seeing the film. So I just had to see the film and see Cushing in a different light. So I watched the film, you know, on my big screen TV. And first of all, I got to say I was impressed with the picture clarity of the DVD itself, because I really wasn't expecting a whole lot, given that it was kind of a double release. Actually, both films are on the same disc, a double-sided disc. So I was a little bit worried about how the picture quality would be and all. But to my surprise, it was pretty good. A pretty bare-bones set, but nonetheless a pretty decent release by Warner Brothers. Both films rated R. Sexual content, nudity, and brief violence. Now, The Curse of Frankenstein. I gotta say, guys, that, you know, after watching the film, I liked it. I was impressed with the movie. Now, this was Hammer Films' first color film, and more than that, it was kind of the make or break kind of movie. It was a movie that was going to prove that they had the ability, the quality, the filmmaking skills to produce a monster film of this caliber and make it stand out from the Universal Frankenstein movies and make it stand on its own two legs. And prove to the world that, you know, yeah, Hammer has the ability to make a decent gothic horror film. So, the film itself, guys, it's one of those movies where it's eye candy to me. There's just a lot to see in this film, a lot to love. From the matte paintings at the beginning of the film where you see the horse going up to the prison, and you see the little matte painting in the background, which is just quaint and quite impressive for the time, to the surroundings themselves, the sound effects, the accoutrements that grace the sets itself. It's just one of those films, like the Dracula films, that, you know, did a great service of creating this illusion that we were back in olden times. I think they did that really well. As a matter of fact, they pulled that off very, very well. Now, this film itself, guys, surprisingly enough, was actually the brainchild of two American writers. The story was conceived by two American writers, and they gave the screenplay to some of the production people at Hammer. And Hammer didn't too much care for the original screenplay that was written. As a matter of fact, guys, once they registered the name of the film, it came across the wires to Universal. And Universal, who actually had done the original Frankenstein with Boris Karloff, actually was very concerned about Hammer producing this film. As a matter of fact, they threatened a lawsuit, and they threatened legal action if the film bore any resemblance to the Universal Frankenstein film. So Hammer had to go back to the script and asked the scriptwriters to pretty much not put in anything in the script that resembled the Universal film. So they got a new script and it was written. They sent it to Universal, and Universal was pretty much, you know, didn't even want to read it. Their whole mindset was, okay, yeah, we could read this, but we're not going to know if you're making similarities to our film until we actually see the film itself. So we're not going to read this. Hammer was a bit dissuaded by this, guys, but they really wanted to make this picture. So they asked for another rewrite. The film was rewritten again. They thought that the film was unfilmable because of the budget that would be required to make it. So for all the work that the Americans had put into the film, they actually sent the screenplay off and had it rewritten. So to placate the original screenwriters, the scriptwriters, Hammer paid them a meager fund just to kind of say, hey, we appreciate your work, we appreciate the time you put into this, but, you know, we're not using your story. And, you know, just to kind of keep things nice between the American cohorts and Hammer itself, they gave a little monetary funds to kind of say, you know, we appreciate your writing, but we're not going to use this story. We can say that the American scriptwriters never really appreciated Hammer's actions and what they did with their script. They felt a little bit, you know, used, and they was disappointed that Hammer didn't use their story. Now, of course, those script writers were Milton Sabosky and Max Rosenberg. They would rise up and form their own company called Amicus, which became Hammer's biggest rival during the golden years of the studio. Now, of course, guys, the script was given to Hammer staples Anthony Hines and Jimmy Sangsta, and they rewrote the story and pretty much got it to a point where, you know, given the budget restrictions, Hammer could easily finance the film and get it made. Now, that meant cuts from the original story. And as a matter of fact, back in those days, Hammer films were oftentimes financed by private owners and anyone basically who had the money to chip in and help out on making the films. The movie ended up going to the very capable hands of Terence Fisher, who would direct the film. And the whole production staff were very much aware of the fact that they were trying to distinguish this film from the Universal classic that had come years earlier. And as a matter of fact, guys, originally when the film was written by Sabosky and Rosenberg, the general idea and assumption of the movie was that the film would star Boris Karloff, who actually played the original Frankenstein. He'd aged quite a bit now, but it was still kind of a given that he would star in the film, and that most of the content of the film would be fairly close to what we saw in the Universal film. Now, of course, Universal objected, so that was definitely out of the question. Now, as I said, a lot of great care went into distinguishing this film from its Universal counterpoint. And the most worrisome thing about that was the makeup itself, because they did not want it to resemble anything that Universal had created for their film. And as a matter of fact, Hammer makeup artist Phil Leakey went through several prosthetics and makeup choices before he finally settled on the final creature. Now, of course, guys, you all know that Christopher Lee played the creature in the film. As a matter of fact, Lee wasn't really chosen because he was a great actor or they thought that he would just be great as the creature. He was actually chosen because of his height. And as a matter of fact, there was an actor before him that was considered, but Lee won out. And the makeup situation itself went through several changes. Phil Leakey actually did several tests on Christopher Lee, and Christopher Lee himself said that some of the makeup choices seemed to be inspired from H.G. Wells, The Island of Dr. Monroe, where he had kind of like an animalistic look. But, you know, in the end, Mr. Leakey was able to create what we saw on screen and to great effect. Now, to play Baron von Frankenstein himself, we have Peter Cushing in the film. And Peter Cushing had already been a staple on British television, and he was sought after to actually play the title character. And I gotta say, guys, you know, I was worried about Peter Cushing in this role because I saw him as such the heroic good guy that I was worried that he might not be able to cross over, and I might not be able to accept him as an evil character. But Peter Cushing pulled it off fabulously, guys. I mean, when he's in the role, you believe. Perfect choice to play this character. Lee's convictions, the motivations that drive this character, the frustration and anguish of this character. Lee pulled it off effectively. When he's in the role of Baron von Frankenstein, he is that character. I was just totally impressed by the fact that when I watched this film, I didn't think of Van Helsing at all, because Peter Cushing made this character his, and it was his role as the evil scientist that actually sold this film for me, guys. And, you know, it's not so much, I mean, we do have the monster in the film, but overall, it's not so much about the monster, it's more about this character's motivations, what drives his characters, his obsession with what he's doing. And he pulls it off amazingly. And, you know, when it comes down to it, guys, this film, just everything to me, melded together perfectly. And I got to say, I really enjoyed this movie. I thought it was a really well made with great performances, great photography, and a really great musical score. Just everything pulled together nicely. And I was not only impressed with it, I was kind of surprised by it. I was surprised that, you know, I had this reaction, that I enjoyed it as much as I did. And it actually single-handedly made me look forward to more of these films. Now, I will say, guys, that, you know, being a lover of Peter Cushing and seeing him in the title role, I did feel kind of sorry for him. Because, you know, he plays a character who is just so motivated by his work. And the need to create life. And he's a decent character at first, who actually wants to help mankind. He wants to benefit mankind. But he gets to a point where he's just, he becomes lost. His way becomes lost. And he loses sight of what he was trying to do. And it gets to a point where, you know, the drive to help humanity turns into an obsession, and he loses sight of what he was trying to do in the beginning, and he doesn't care about people, he doesn't care about who gets in his way, he doesn't care about what he has to do. The only thing that matters is the end result, and whoever gets hurt in the middle, he doesn't care. And that's a really complex kind of character, and Baron von Frankenstein is a really well-written, complex character brought to life immeasurably by Peter Cushing. Peter Cushing is just great in this role. And, you know, where we have Van Helsing, I would even say that Baron von Frankenstein is probably more of a complex character and more, probably better played by Cushing, as far as he being a dynamic character, which is just layered with all of these nuances that make us all human, and the things that, you know, push the envelope and all that. So Cushing's performance was just magnificent in this, I gotta say. And then there's Chris Lee, who, as the monster himself, very, very suited for the role. I gotta say, very, very suited for the role. As a matter of fact, guys, all the elements that brought this film to life were just amazing. I was really impressed with The Curse of Frankenstein. And I gotta say that there were surprises in the film. Some of the gore was surprising for the time. Some of the situations where, you know, Cushing is the doctor, the evil scientist, is having an affair with the help, and he plans on marrying his cousin, and you just have a lot of dynamics in the film that really kind of push the envelope. And even the relationship that Frankenstein has with his assistant Paul, it starts out as a really nice and amazing warm kinship that soon erupts into violence and regret, remorse, and that friendship is utterly ruined by the selfishness and the convictions of Frankenstein. So, you know, in Paul, we have the ability as a member of the audience to see this slow metamorphosis that is becoming Frankenstein. He's, this friendship is just becoming warped. He sees the ugliness in Frankenstein, the changes, the selfishness, the obsession, the need to do whatever you have to do regardless. And Peter Cushing is really, he's a terrible, terrible person in this film. He does some really terrible things. And it's really kind of spectacular when you see Cushing, who plays the evil scientist, who is willing to do all these evil things, despicable things. But in his mind, it's all justified because of the end goal. He doesn't care about what he's doing. He doesn't have the ability to see his own faults. It's for science. It's for bettering mankind. But at the same time, he's lost the ability to see that he's doing this for himself and not so much the people on the earth. But it's a wonderful, wonderful performance. Peter Cushing should have won the equivalent of an Academy Award for his performance in this role, because it was just, you know, magnanimous. And I got to say, too, guys, the scene in the film where we have the elderly grandfather, the blind grandfather with his grandson that the monster encounters in the forest, it's kind of heart-wrenching. I really, you know, felt sad about that whole scene. I felt affected by that whole scene. I just thought good film, guys. Very, very good film. And I highly have to recommend The Curse of Frankenstein. I think it's... I would say, you know, it's been a while since I've seen the Universal Frankenstein film, and I need to go back and watch it again. But as it stands, I think, you know, as far as complexity goes, this film inches ahead of the Universal counterpart. And I think, you know, being Hammer's first color film, it paved the way for other great horror films like Dracula and some of the other later films that came out. And the film was released, guys, a huge success. I think in terms of British money converting to America, I think it cost more or less $270,000 to $300,000 to make this film, and it pulled in $8 million. And it was a big hit in the UK. I mean, there were lines around the buildings to get to see this film, and it was a really, really big success in the United States. And the film never really received any great reviews when it came out. It was more or less, you know, we use the term gore porn. It was pretty much relegated to just a disturbing, gross film that, you know, shouldn't have been made. And a lot of the critics just did not give the film its due. But, you know, in years to pass, now it's considered a classic horror film. But the film was very successful. Opened the door for Hammer. Put Hammer on the map. And, you know, Hammer was actually worried about, you know, financing for their films. But with this movie, a couple of the American companies stepped up to finance some of the films. And Hammer ended up going on making films for Universal, Paramount, several other American companies. So the Curse of Frankenstein actually put them on the map. And the film itself, guys, I think it's just a wonderfully classic film. And I can't wait to get it on Blu-ray. Because, it, you know, I never could have said this about a Frankenstein film until watching this one. But this is probably one of my favorite, all-time, number one favorite Frankenstein movies. But anyway, guys, there you have my thoughts on the original Hammer film, The Curse of Frankenstein. I'm looking forward to watching the sequel to that film. And I just really enjoyed this movie. So thank you all for watching, and I shall see you all later.